Thank you for joining us and agreeing to talk to us about your RCT on smart cards in Andhra Pradesh and how they've been so successfully implemented. So my questions here to you are going to be largely based on that. Your study is among the largest evaluations using the RCT technique for evaluating program. So, and it's one of the most efficient studies around. What were the crucial political economy decisions that were taken by the government of Andhra Pradesh that gave a big push to the program? I'm talking about the smart card program.
Yeah, so I think, you know, so the fact that the study was large in some sense just had to do with the fact that we were studying a program across an entire state as it was being rolled out, or at least across 8 districts. So the population covered by the rollout was about 20 million people. But I think the question you have is more about the implementation of the program itself. And I think the main political decision that the government of AP had made was that they were one of the champions of NREGS to begin with. And so AP has always been a leading implementer of NREGS, both in terms of, you know, the quality of the processes they put in place. If you look at the states that were drawing the maximum NREGS funding, it was AP. They had put in place the social audits. And so the smart cards was another of those major flagship initiatives that the government of AP had to try and improve the implementation of NREGS. And since it was a very clear political priority for YSR and the YSR government that NREGS would be implemented well, I think that's kind of where the decision flew from, that this is something that they would do.
And the decision to use technology in a big way.
Exactly, which also is something that Andhra has traditionally been a leader in terms of technology adopted governance. And so that was, you know, it was kind of, they were benefiting from the legacy of Chandrababu Naidu, who had made investments in a bureaucracy that was much more empowered and much more comfortable with using technology for large ambitious projects of improving governance. So in that sense, like, I mean, Andhra was almost the ideal setting, I mean, for this to roll out. And even now, I mean, they continue to be at the forefront.
Yeah. And you mentioned that implementing the project of this scale is very complex. So what were the key technical, administrative and political challenges that were faced?
Yeah, so I mean, you know, we have an extensive report that kind of, in addition to the academic paper, documents the process of implementation, right? And I think, again, this is more of a project management question, but on the technical side, there's always complicated issues with how do you write down the technical specs and write a contract in a world where the technology is changing so fast. Right? So you write a contract, you have a tender, you have somebody coming in, and then the technology has changed. And so then how do you do price discovery again if you need to change the terms of the contract? How do you renegotiate? So these are just like practical problems of managing a huge technology project in a government setting. Right? Now, the other technical problems are because you were trying to move an entire payment system. So there were so many pieces of this that had to work. I mean, you had to be able to enroll tens of lakhs of beneficiaries. You had to issue the smart cards and make sure people got the cards. You had to make sure that the readers and the POS devices were present in every village and that they would function. You had to make sure that cash management in the last mile was taken care of. So the problem with these large complex projects is if even one piece breaks down from the perspective of the beneficiary, if he doesn't see his cash, he doesn't care why it broke down. And that's why it can be risky and challenging to take on such a large thing. So I think, you know, that's the nature of the political, sorry, the administrative challenges have to do with things like contracting. The political, the technical challenges just have to do with the many, many complex pieces. And the political challenge is that even when you have backing from the political leadership at the state level, you are still going to get resistance at the grassroots level when there are vested interests who were making, benefiting from the rents from the earlier system. And if what the new system is doing is cutting out corruption and cutting leakage, that is being felt by some of the existing power structures, and they will try to resist in some way or the others. And we saw this in many cases. In many villages, the local strongman would want to control the hiring of the business correspondent so that they would have some say in the distribution of the cash. So those were the political challenges, and the government had to kind of keep pushing and pushing and pushing. But the good news is that because it was a political priority at the top, the bureaucracy was empowered to then be able to continuously push for better implementation.
And what were the human challenges? Like, how did you generate trust for, you know, using a new system in the people who were going to use it?
Correct. So again, when you say you, I had nothing to do with this, right? I mean, that all that we were doing was research, right? So in a way, what I'm answering are questions about program implementation that really were figured out by the government and not by us, right? But, I mean, the human side of this is, I think, the most important part was just stability and leadership, I mean, in the government, a dedicated project management unit. So you had a principal secretary, the first one who was in charge of this had a tenure of 4 to 5 years, and then you had somebody else with a tenure of 3 to 4 years. And they had a dedicated smart cards unit with a program manager, like, who was kind of a young technology savvy graduate of IRMA, who they managed to get as a program manager. So the people side of this, they built a dedicated architecture. They had a retired, I think, SBI official who was also kind of a project director. So they had just built a dedicated human resources team. And then they would have, in terms of getting the message down to the districts and that human side, they would have regular monthly kind of review meetings with the district level teams. And there was just a very continuous effort to make sure that implementation was happening. And they also had very high quality MIS that would give them monthly updates just through official digital data on the extent of take up and diffusion.
In one of your presentation, I've seen that you've mentioned that local business correspondents are crucial to making payments. So, would you like to elaborate on that?
It's a pretty basic concept in financial inclusion that it's not enough to just provide a bank account. You need to provide a way for the beneficiary in the village to be able to access cash as and when he or she needs it. So, there's not much. Now, if you move to a completely cashless society, then yes, then you don't need the cash. The money is sitting in your account. If you're able to go and authenticate a transaction with a fingerprint and an Aadhaar payment bridge and the money is transferred, then you're in a cashless society, right? But that's not where we are. So if you're doing DBTs, there is still a need to figure out how the beneficiary is going to see their cash, because psychologically, like, rural India is not at a place when they can function cashlessly. And so the business correspondent is the critical last mile infrastructure of managing the payments and cash management in the last mile. And Andhra, again, had a bit of a head start in this area because they had invested in the self-help group movement. And so you had empowered women who were educated at least to 10th pass and comfortable handling large amounts of cash. And that kind of allowed them to build up a business correspondence system that worked very well here.
So the key was to getting people from the local who knew the local backgrounds and who could generate a little bit of trust in the people who were using the technology.
Well, yeah, absolutely, right? I mean, because the last mile face of the smart card program in terms of who was making the payments and giving you the cash was, in fact, a woman typically from that village. And again, government of AP in their hiring norms for who the business correspondent would be had specified a whole bunch of criteria, including, you know, being a woman, being at least a 10th pass, then preference to be given to underprivileged, marginalized communities. And I think they also had a requirement that the BC should not be related to the sarpanch or anybody holding office in the village. So, you know, they tried their best to put in the fair bits of checks and balances, and for the most part, that worked quite well.
The smart card program is very like what India is trying to implement on a larger scale using the Aadhaar payment. So what are the key lessons that kind of a system can draw from what has happened in Andhra Pradesh?
Correct. So I think, you know, from a technical side, the world moves very fast. The technology is now very, very different. I mean, in a way, the smart cards was really biometric payments 1.0 because it was offline authentication. It was, you know, very cash intensive. Now, as you move to a more Aadhaar DBT-based society, obviously, like, the technology is different. You're doing online authentication. That comes with its benefits and challenges. The benefits are it's interoperable. You can kind of go collect the benefits anywhere. With the smart cards, your data is only stored on that one local POS machine because it's offline authentication. So the benefits of online are the portability and the deduplication because you're now verifying against like a master server. The costs are you need constant connectivity. So in the offline system, you didn't need connectivity because the local reader could authenticate and you could just upload the data when you got a link at the end of the day. So in that sense, there's going to be challenges. So I think the main lesson overall from the AP Smart Card experience for states and departments that are now trying to link their programs with Aadhaar and doing more cash-based welfare programming is first to just have a dedicated implementation team so that there is a core mission that's able to implement the project with just stability and that they learn and they kind of get better as they go on. I think the other very important thing politically was, even though it is very tempting in the short run to make the payments mandatory on authentication, that it was actually a wise choice of the government of Andhra Pradesh, that they tried to make the smart cards convenient, but they did not mandate it. So if you were a beneficiary who missed the enrollment and didn't get your smart card, it's not like you were denied your benefits, right? So, which meant that that minimized the potential backlash. So if you had a system where you said you have to have a card to get paid, but people were not able to get their cards, then suddenly, like, you know, you have this backlash. And in India, even if 2% of people are not getting their benefits, that's 20 million people. And so that's a large enough number of people that you're going to hear all that negative kind of feedback. So the big advice I would have to governments trying to kind of move to Aadhaar-based DBT is focus in the short run, the first 1-2 years, focus less on the fiscal saving and more on the beneficiary experience. And so if the beneficiary experience improves as a result of this, then over time the fiscal saving will happen automatically, because the ghost will get weeded out, the over-reporting will get weeded out. So that happened. So, but if you try to start from day one by saying, I want to achieve fiscal savings, the problem is that, say your outlay goes down by 40%. You look at that outlay number and you say, great, you know, I saved 40%. The problem is you don't know how much of that is exclusion error. And if some of that is exclusion error, the genuine beneficiaries did not get their benefits, then you're going to risk a political backlash. So out of that 40%, maybe 30% was genuine waste, which you saved, but 10% is exclusion. But the media brouhaha around the 10% exclusion, that echo chamber, and because we're also in a culture of policy making by anecdote, right? Yeah. Like, I mean, even if 4 people don't get their benefits, the media will go there, find that story and amplify that. So it's kind of also, so politically, ethically, practically, like, I mean, it makes sense to not try and mandate in the beginning, because it's just going to backfire, right? So now, this doesn't mean you don't pressure the system to try and every month say, you know, if you have a transaction that was not authenticated, then the problem, for example, in AP smart cards is the way the enrollment would happen. The enrollment would happen on a camp mode, okay? So the camp, there would be an enrollment camp in a village, and if you missed it, then it became really difficult to go get your smart card. You had to go to district headquarters, and typically a poor villager could not do that, right? So one thing that should hopefully be possible, and now that Aadhaar penetration is close to 1 billion people, this should be perhaps less of an issue, is that make it feasible so that even if the first time or second time you don't have a card or link or something, that you're able to collect that data so that once you make one manual payment, that the next time it can be authenticated. So I think, you know, overall I'm cautiously optimistic. But the other thing which is worth thinking about, and this, for example, is an issue now when the government is thinking about DBT and kerosene, okay, where the idea is, the basic reform idea is very sensible, okay, which is you have these subsidized prices and so you have leakage and diversion. So idea is get rid of dual pricing, have one price and then transfer the benefit straight to the beneficiary's account. They use the cash and they pay the balance. The problem is that if the beneficiary has to go to his bank or BC every single month to collect the cash and then bring it to the PDS shop, you're adding to his transaction cost, right? So it should be possible that even if you do DBT kerosene, that the beneficiary can authenticate and then the transfer is made directly into the dealer's account. So you kind of reduce that round tripping. So a lot of thinking is always required in terms of the beneficiary experience, which might not always be taking place. And that would be like a really important piece of advice I would give to any government thinking about these kind of reforms, is put the beneficiary experience first.
The horse before the cart.
Oh, I mean, yeah, I mean, I'm not a big fan of just like platitudes, but you know, I think that's the point is that system reform design usually happens sitting in an office in Delhi, right? I mean, but the design of these reforms need to be guided by the user experience, and then everything will take care of itself.
That makes complete sense. And I think there have been pilots which have also suggested, I think there was a pilot in Delhi on kerosene DBT transfers. Anyways, thank you so much for coming here and sharing your experience on the AP experience. And we hope to have you back soon.